The Fair Melusina, Mendelssohn's depiction of the feminine spirit of legend who lives in the waters of sacred springs and rivers. Sir Thomas Beecham conducted the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra in that EMI Classics recording made in Abbey Road Studios on the 6th of November 1958. Sir Thomas was 79 and a half years old, and his players, and when the disc was issued, his audiences marvelled at the undiminished energy, rhythmic control, and subtle flexibility that had been just some of his hallmarks for so long. He was by then a legend in his own time, and not only as a conductor. Beecham was a household name to people who weren't actually interested in classical music. They, just like those who were classical music lovers, knew of him as the famous enfant terrible, who publicly railed against the artistic and financial attitudes of the British musical establishment and the teaching institutions that he had largely ignored and bypassed in his formative years. Defying all their traditions, from near the outset of his career, as the 20th century dawned, Thomas Beecham was the man who, to a great extent, taught himself his art and craft, and created his own vehicles to attain the new high standards and radical concepts of orchestral and operatic performance he aspired to. So it was that he set up his own new orchestras that quickly became acclaimed as among the greatest virtuoso ensembles in the world. So it was, too, that he created his own opera seasons and brought to England a consistent high level of international operatic performance that was unprecedented in its scope and quality. And it wasn't just at home that he was enormously admired. As a guest conductor in the major cities of Europe and the United States of America, he held audiences spellbound in the concert hall, the opera house, and also, just as it was in other countries, in their homes, where his rapidly growing discography became highly prized connoisseurs' possessions. By the early 1930s, Sir Thomas Beecham, who'd been knighted back in 1916 when he was just 36 years old, had achieved a level of international fame and stature that gave him a status akin to the very most highly respected celebrity conductors of the world. He'd also gained the reputation of one of the most flamboyant and controversial personalities in musical history. His ingenious and sometimes highly caustic wit was a delight to his admirers, and it could be a very painful thorn in the side of its recipients. Added to that were the often ill-informed comments he received about his position as the heir to the famous Beecham's Pills Company. This heirdom did help him to achieve some independence in his pursuits, but it certainly did not provide a condition or any kind of incentive for him to be a wealthy amateur, as was sometimes so inaccurately said. Throughout his 60-year conducting career, Thomas Beecham was a deeply serious musician of great industry and profound knowledge, whose methods both of study and performance were wholly unconventional. From the start, he had a passionate ideal, and it was going to take a tremendous amount of thought, work, and talent to realise it. Taking up the story for us from the early days now is the author of the exhaustive detailed biography, Thomas Beecham, An Obsession with Music, John Lucas.
He had this vision of making Britain a musical nation. I don't think we realised at the time how difficult it was, music, and how it was financed. I mean, there was no arts council, there were no public subsidies. What money there was came from society individuals like Lord Howard de Walden and people like that. And the Beecham's Pills firm was started by his grandfather, who was also called Thomas. Now, old Thomas had been a shepherd in his time, and he administered the pills to his sheep, and then he discovered that they worked very well on him too. So he started a little company, and it grew and grew and grew. And by the time that young Thomas was born as the conductor, it was really extremely profitable. And old Thomas was still alive, but Beecham's father, Joseph, was running it, who was a brilliant businessman. Unlike Sir Thomas, who everybody imagines was also a brilliant businessman, but actually he was pretty hopeless. He was very good at spending money. After he spent all his own, he then spent everybody else's, and he was very good at getting hold of it. He had Lady Cunard, who was a great source of finance after his father had died. But it was always a terrific struggle, and he was always in the courts with his money problems. And there was the famous remark by the judge who, when Beecham's counsel said he had spent all this money for the public good, and the judge said, "What public good?" He said, "Providing music." And the judge said, "There are more important things than that."
Not for Thomas Beecham, there weren't. That incident occurred in 1932, nearly three decades after he'd begun his lifelong striving for funding to underwrite his artistic visions. From the start of his career, he'd been dissatisfied with musical standards in his country. And by 1909, he'd resolved to find the money to set up his own orchestra of hand-picked players, the Beecham Symphony Orchestra. It was the first of three orchestras he created and retained complete control over while he was their music director. The others were the London Philharmonic and the Royal Philharmonic. The Beecham Symphony Orchestra lasted 5 years, and it made such a strong impression with its fiery attack and disciplined precision that it and its music director made a number of recordings at a time when very limited recording techniques made orchestral discs usually sound very inadequate. Beecham's discs stood out as being exceptional for the time. They somehow defied the technical restrictions and conveyed a far wider range of colour and dynamics than was usually heard in those days. They also conveyed some of the rhythmic strength, attacking impact, and characteristically flexible phrasing that were to become such famous Beecham qualities in later days. Here's an extract from Stravinsky's ballet, The Firebird. It was recorded in 1916 with former Beecham Symphony Orchestra members who were now playing in the orchestra of another major Beecham initiative, the Beecham Opera Company, which for 4 years gave England its first real taste of regular quality opera performances. And, by the way, Stravinsky's ballet, The Firebird, was only 6 years old at this time.